Good morning, College Park Presbyterian Church. You are here. You made it to our YouTube video. We're going to be doing things a little bit differently this week because we're trying to keep people safe because of the virus, but we're also going to do as much as we can to keep as many familiar elements as we can and really make you feel like you are at home in your home church. And so to start off with, I feel like a College Park Presbyterian Church worship service begins about 3 to 5 minutes late, and we spend that time chit-chatting. And so while other people are joining us and figuring out what it takes to get in the premiere on time, I want to just have some slides up on the screen for you, and I'll be back in a couple minutes.
Sacrifice, if not joined with my life, I sing in vain tonight. May the words I say and the things I do make my life song sing, bring a smile.
Let my
Okay, I hate to cut off all of the chatter that is happening around this community. Hopefully there is some chatter going on in the chat room we have in the premiere. This is all new. So I have some announcements for you. I'm going to talk about how we are doing church over the next couple of weeks and what that looks like. To start with, this is what our services are going to look like. We're going to get better at it. We're going to figure out more of what will make this a more enjoyable experience and get feedback from the community, and we're going to get better over time. But this is the basic format of how we're going to do it. It is not a live stream. This is called premiered and pre-recorded. It's actually Saturday right now where I am while I'm talking to you, but I am also on my computer watching this video with you so I can interact with the community. That is better than live stream in a couple of important ways. The churches that are live streaming because they live stream every Sunday. Live streaming is a great way to have an event that's live and where people who can't attend the live event can have some semblance of what it's like to be there. But when we can pre-record, that gives me the ability to edit, and so I can have visual aids and I can have helps for you. We can have the effects of like what's going on the screen. It also helps with connectivity. So if there are technical disorders, you know, in some of the live streams we've done in the last week, many of them have crashed because we just didn't have enough bandwidth. And that's also true on y'all's end. If you are not technical, live streams are harder to access. This is easier. And then number three is copyright. The rules for live streaming are a lot more strict than the rules for pre-recorded videos regarding copyright and what you can get sued for and what the church can be in legal trouble for. And so by pre-recording, we actually protect the church from lawsuits, and we have access to a greater diversity of music and of visual aids and things that we're going to enjoy that's going to help make this experience more interactive, more holistic, more full for all of you. Now, I need to talk about the future of the church a little bit. Basically, all of the events that are on the March calendar, they're canceled. They're effectively not going to happen as scheduled. But I am working with our leaders and with the members who lead the groups to try to put together new and safe ways to put on those kinds of events. I'm going to have a session meeting right after this. We're going to do our session meeting via Zoom. And so we'll have a Zoom conference. That's a video conference. And once we have figured out how to use that as a church, I'm going to be sharing with other people how to use that. And so I've already talked with Kay about doing women's circle over Zoom. I've talked with Jack about helping to teach people that format. So that'll be a way to do interactive stuff. I'm also working with Paige to find a new way to bring our brief statement of faith class to you. And so we are working on all sorts of those things, but this is, you're at the forefront of it right now. This service is numero uno, the first thing we're going to work out, and then we're just going to continue to add to it and add to it because we are following the schedule of the Orange County Public Schools. And the Orange County Public Schools are canceled until April 15th. They're not going to come back until after Easter. So that means we're going to do Easter in a new way. We're going to do Easter I'm not sure if we'll do something additional and something with cars or some other ways to interact with Easter, but we're going to do it at a distance without spreading viruses. And so it's going to be new. And it's going to be a challenge, but it's also going to be an opportunity. You know, I think it's a really beautiful thing that we have a way now to turn every living room into a worship center, and that we have a reason now to gather in groups of five or fewer in order to fellowship together and witness the glory of God. It's a lot like the early church in some ways. And without bragging,
I really feel lucky. I really feel privileged to be your pastor at a time like this, because for once I feel like I know what I'm doing. I have gifts and I have skills and I have a background, and a lot of it I feel like has been leading to this, leading to the ability to create community and to shepherd and to care and to teach when we're not able to gather in traditional ways, and when we have to think of new and creative ways to get stuff done. That's really what I specialize in. But of course, knowing what I'm doing and specializing in it, that is not the same as everything going off without a hitch. In fact, that's the opposite of it. We expect hitches. There are going to be hitches, especially this first week. Things are gonna happen that we don't expect. It might be that YouTube will like play a 30-second commercial in the middle of our worship service, and I won't know that that was gonna happen, and that's, it might be that people have trouble getting online. It might be that so many people watching church on the internet at 10:30 on Sunday mornings causes some kind of problem. Something unforeseen is going to happen, and that's okay. That's okay. We're going to figure it out, and we're going to figure it out together. So those are our plans going forward, and I'm really excited to meet you next week with some more specific announcements as we figure out what some of the other elements of church look like. In the meantime, let's figure out together what more elements of our Sunday service look like, and you can go ahead and stand in your living rooms and pass the keys. What I would encourage you to do is to give a comment on the chat room, that just greet an individual person. Greet somebody you know on the chat room, and then maybe greet somebody you don't know and introduce yourself while we're interacting together in this virtual community. You can do that now. You don't have to wait for me to stop talking. That's okay.
Good morning, and peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Good morning. How are you today?
Hello. Glad you came. Okay. I don't take a very good picture.
And also we're good.
Good morning, Pastor Ryan. Are you keeping your social distance? I'm concerned about you. Talk to you later. Bye.
If you would like to be one of the voices that greets the community, that your face is shown next week when we do the passing of the peace, what you can do is just, if you take out your phone, if you have any kind of a smartphone or even a flip phone with a video capability, and record a video of yourself, and just record yourself saying hello, record yourself saying what you would say during the passing of the peace if we were live and here in the sanctuary together, and I will edit those together, and I'll string them together for the passing of the peace next week. In the meantime, I want to pray a prayer of invocation over us. Will you join me in prayer? Holy God, we trust that you are in this place, that you are here where I am filming, and we trust that you are here where I am watching, and where all of these, your beloved children, are watching. And we thank you, and we pray your will be done as we continue in worship of your holy name. Amen.
Amen. The tradition at College Park Presbyterian Church is to begin our service with a call to worship that is in the form of a responsive reading, usually a responsive reading taken from the Psalms. In this virtual worship space, I think a responsive reading is going to be hard to do effectively, and it's going to be hard to make that feel really meaningful. And so what I want to invite you instead to do is a unison reading with me. So I'm going to read from Psalm 121, and I'd invite you to read along with me
while you're at home. Take out your Bibles. We'll put it on the screen too, but I think in your own Bible it's going to be more meaningful. And try to match my voice and know that you are matching the voice of your brothers and sisters from this church community in their own spaces where they're watching these videos as well. This is Psalm 121. It's a psalm of ascent. So it's a psalm about wanting to go back to Jerusalem. A psalm about wanting to go back to the place where we worship. Let's read it together. I lift my eyes up to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. Amen. So, traditionally, at College Park Presbyterian Church, we begin our worship services with a call to worship. Usually that call to worship is taken from the songs, and it's read responsively so that the leader will read a portion and the people will read a portion. Preferably the people reading a portion that is parallel in meaning so that it matches, because the songs are full of these rhymes, this parallelism. Since we're gathered in a virtual worship space this week, I thought a responsive reading would be ill-advised, that it wouldn't feel as meaningful for us. But what I want to try together is a unison reading. And so if you will open to Psalm 121. Psalm 121 is a beautiful psalm, and it's a psalm of ascents. It's a psalm that people would sing when they were traveling to Jerusalem, a song about wanting to be back in the place of worship. And if you'll read that with me, I'll try to read that at a cadence and a pace that you can read along out loud, and we will know that there are people all over Orlando who are reading it out loud with us as we all read. I lift up my eyes from the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. Amen. Let's join together in song with the singing of our first hymn.
I've got peace like a river.
Amen. Well, it's the fourth Sunday of the month, and you know what that means. Every fourth Sunday, we celebrate with a special offering for our compassion child, Rukiatu Kampatore. Rukiatu Kampatore lives in Burkina Faso, Africa, and she has very little to live on and very little opportunity to make her own way, so she relies upon our donations to live and to work and to better herself. She's 17 years old now, and we have walked with her throughout her life and continue to provide the things she needs for daily necessities, things like food and soap. And in some ways, I feel like we can appreciate some more of the difficult supply lines and the hard time getting daily essentials because of what we're going through now. Now, I understand that you are not going to be able to come up and put small bills in this jar or this can the way you normally are able to, and that's okay. That's completely understandable. But I do think that you have something to offer, and I think that it's a beautiful thing that we normally give our offerings in honor of a special life event or a birthday or something we want to acknowledge as a church community. So if you have something you want to acknowledge in the chat room as you remember Rukiatu, I think that's really appropriate. I also want to challenge you that maybe instead of giving money, we are able to give letters. Rukiatu regularly writes to us, and she shares about even just mundane things in her life, like what she bought at the store, and you're invited to do the same thing. So if you want to write a letter of encouragement to Rukiatu, or a letter that shares what you're going through as an offering, instead of a financial offering this month, because we are in excess, we've given more generously than we need to, than our limits with Compassion International, and what's extra goes to birthday and Christmas gifts. So what we don't do enough of, though, is relate to Rukiatu and to reach out with relationship. And so while we're learning to reach out to one another in relationship, though we're physically separated, let's reach out to Rukiatu. So write up a letter, write up an encouragement, even if you put an encouragement for Rukiatu on the chat, we will get it to her. You can email me, you can email Tiffany, and let's give that as an offering to Rukiatu and spend a few minutes hearing what are some things this month that we want to honor, some important passings. You know, I think this is a pivotal time for a lot of people. There are celebrations, graduations, birthdays, and parties are getting canceled. Ways to mark time aren't happening. Let's take this time to mark time. I apologize because standing here, I don't know how interactive we are able to be as a church. I don't know how people are responding to the new experience. But I'd encourage you to give something. Say something. Try it. Take a risk. By way of a ministry through music this week, I want to share with you a song that has been special to me. This is actually a song that I have wanted to share
many times in the past, and I haven't had the gifts or the skills to deliver it for you because I don't have the musical abilities that I feel like I would need to share the song. That's a warning, because that means I'm about to sing. But don't worry, I won't sing for very long. The hook of this song, the repeating musical phrase, is a repeating musical phrase that I carry with me and that I invite you to carry with you when you're afraid, when you feel in danger, when you don't know what is going to happen next, when it's dark out and you can't see. And it helps you to know the Lord is with you. The refrain goes like this. No matter what, no matter what may come, no matter what may come, I will not let you go. I know that was off key, but that's how I sing it. And I hum it to myself frequently, whenever I'm unsure, whenever I'm nervous. So I want you to hear the song sung on key, and I want it to get stuck in your head, because I want you to have it in the weeks ahead, to be able to hum to yourself, to know that whatever may come, God won't let you go. And I pray that this song would be a blessing to you as it has been to me.
No matter.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, therefore, let us confess our sins using the traditional words printed in the Book of Common Worship and visible below on your screens. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends, who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ loves us. Christ prays for us. Christ died for us. Remember your baptism and be at peace. You are forgiven. It is appropriate for us to gather for the prayers of the people. Now, I know I normally lead the prayers of the people over at the pulpit, but I'm trying to explore the sanctuary in a new way, because when you gather here in person, your heads are able to swivel around and you're able to participate in all of these different important symbolic images in our architecture that you don't get the opportunity to with a camera that's just mounted in one place. So I'm trying to move around, and I think it is important and meaningful to engage in the prayers of the people under the cross and with the chain. This chain is a symbol of the prayers that have been given in this congregation for 2+ people, for people who we know who are not in our family, that don't know Jesus the way we know Jesus and that need to know Jesus. Prayers that God would send workers into his harvest field, and one answer to those prayers that we can celebrate. I think there are more than this. I think there is more that we have to be thankful for in our prayer life as College Park Presbyterian Church. But sometimes new elements of worship and new elements of liturgy are a challenge, and they take some time to get used to. But we're getting used to new things right now. And it is a moment where I'm going to ask you for prayers. In fact, I'm asking you for prayers right now. I hope you're sharing them on the chat. I don't know which side the chat is going to be on. I think it's over there. Either way, as you're sharing prayers and as we are praying for one another in that room, I want to mark that in some way that's visible, so that when we gather back together, we have an awareness of the things that we have asked God for and the things that we've thanked God for, especially those prayers which are pivotal to our mission, to the mission that Jesus has sent us on as a church to go and make disciples of all nations. So take this opportunity now to quiet your hearts and pray for the people that God has put in your life to minister to. So many people have been praying more missional prayers since 2019. We've started to pray prayers of thanksgiving and prayers for people that we're reaching out to and people that we're trying to express God's love to and people we're trying to care for in our wider circle. And that's such a beautiful thing. But God, we don't want to miss those people. We don't want to lose those people, God, the people that we think of in the quietness of our hearts now. Our two people. And more than that, our plus people, the people besides the two. The people we love. The people we care about. The people we may not get to see for weeks and weeks. Send workers, Lord. Send us. Find us ways to do your will. And also for everything that's expressed over here, God, for all of these prayers, all of these concerns, everything that's emerging, for Alex and his pulled muscle, God, for the people who are going to be learning Zoom, for Betty and Laurie, people who are not able to be with us on the internet. We remember them. We feel their presence through the love we care for them here among us in this virtual space. For all this and more, Lord, we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A response that we have chosen to come after the prayers of the people is a giving of tithes and of offerings. Now, I have spoken with some of you who are concerned. There is good reason to believe that we and many charitable organizations are going to miss out on receiving the giving that we depend on to continue to function in this season. There is reason to believe that many people will lose jobs and they won't be able to afford that their 10% of their income will go down to zero. And there's also concern practically that if we're not passing the plate, how will we receive funding? I do want to kind of quiet those fears. I did rebuild the College Park Presbyterian Church website this week, and next week I'm going to be applying my technical skills to figure out a way to give online. But for many of us, giving online, even if it was an option and it was easy and it was smooth, isn't comfortable. You can send an envelope. You know the address of the church. It's on the screen there. And if we take a couple weeks to open the envelope, it will be okay, but you can still participate in the financial ministry of this church that way. More important than all of that, though, we're going to be okay. This church is going to keep standing for a little while. We have time, and we can miss a week of financial giving if we need to. That's of course not what we want. We don't want to deprive you of that opportunity to participate. But that's not something you need to be anxious for at this moment, and that's not a reason you need to motivate your giving. Instead, take this time to offer yourself Take this time to lay down on that altar, like Isaac did. You are sacrificing so much. You are offering so much for the sake of the world. You who are feeling well, who don't have the virus, are changing your daily activities so as not to spread it. Take some time to dedicate that. Dedicate that activity as an act of devotion to God, as an act of love for neighbor. When you wash your hands, when you sing the doxology, focus on God. When you stay inside, when you avoid touching things, when you change your habits and your lifestyle and your workflow and your worship, you belong to God. And so everything you're sacrificing, including the food you'd like to eat, and the money you'd like to spend, and the way you would like to participate with your friends, lay it on the altar. Give your offering to God. This is your spiritual act of worship.
Old Testament reading today is from Jeremiah 29, verses 4 through 14. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what you produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons, and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let the prophets and the diviners who are among you deceive you, and do not listen to the dreams that they dream. For it is a lie that they are prophesying to you in my name. I did not send them, says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then when you call upon me and I come and pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I will let you find me, says the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I have sent you into exile. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your New Testament reading comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 6. Hear now verses 25 to 34. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? Why do you worry about your clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor do they spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow, it's thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? You of little faith. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat? Or what will we drink? Or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things, but strive for the kingdom of God and for his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you as well. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. This is the word of the Lord. I'm going to come preach down here like I used to.
So, in case it is not clear, I have decided to postpone the ending of Saga Genesis. We will resume Saga Genesis and learn the story of Jacob and his son Joseph and his son Ephraim when we are able to gather again in person. I just don't think it's fair to you to have one part of a series delivered in a particular style and a particular kind of messaging, and another part of the series delivered in a totally different style. And what's more than that, I thought with the changes in so many of our lives, it was an important time to see God in prayer and to deliver a live sermon for this congregation. You know, right now in the world, there are thousands of pastors who are putting out content on the internet. Every pastor is trying to figure out how it is that we be the body of Christ when the body of Christ can't gather in the church building, which is a really exciting question to ask. But one thing that it means is that you and me have access to better preachers than me, with better IT departments, who are recording better sermons and better content that's available on the internet from the same living room or the same computer room or the same, let's face it, some of you are still in bed, the same bed that you are watching this from now. And so why are you watching this one? What am I providing that isn't just a drop in the ocean compared to the great content that's out there? And I want to be clear, the answer is not that you are supposed to listen to my stuff and not their stuff because I own you and you owe your loyalty to College Park Presbyterian Church in some undefinable way that means that you have to avoid other good content that could serve you spiritually at this time. That's not true. Please, if you have space in your heart for more, for more messages, for more learning. If you are home from work and you have extra time on your hands and you feel inclined to use that time to grow in your knowledge of God and your understanding of the scriptures using great resources that are out there, use them all. You could go to 14 churches this week by engaging in the amount of live stream content that's there, and I invite you to. That's totally fine, but why am I adding my voice? And my belief is that when I give a sermon to a community, that I am exegeting not only the text, but my life and their lives in context. And so, even though it's Saturday where I'm talking to you, I'm talking to you, College Park Presbyterian Church, and I am thinking about what you're worried about this week, and what you're worried about this week is the coronavirus. And that's worrisome. And that had me thinking a lot about worry. Had me thinking a lot about Christ's commandment not to worry about your life, or your food, or your clothes. Most importantly, not to worry about tomorrow. I love the way the King James Version renders that verse. What they say is, sufficient for the day is the evil thereof. The injunction of Christ against worry, his instruction, is a compassionate injunction, and yet it is a tough one. He's saying something that's difficult to hear, especially someone who has a legitimate reason to worry, like we do. In fact, in some ways, I relate to this this funny clip by Bob Newhart I want to share with you.
Oh, yes. Fear of being buried alive in a box.
Yes. Yes, that's me. Should I lay down?
Oh, no. We don't do that anymore. Just have a seat. And let me tell you a bit about our billing. I charge $5 for the first 5 minutes. And then absolutely nothing after that. How does that sound?
That sounds great. Too good to be true, as a matter of fact.
Well, I can almost guarantee you that our session won't last the full 5 minutes. Now, we don't do any insurance billing, so you would either have to pay in cash or by check.
Wow. Okay.
And I don't make change.
All right.
And go.
Go.
Well, tell me about the problem that you wish to address.
Oh, okay. Well, I have this fear of being buried alive in a box. I start thinking about being buried alive and I begin to panic.
Has anyone ever tried to bury you alive in a box?
No, but truly thinking about it does make my life horrible. I mean, I can't go through tunnels or be in an elevator or in a house, anything boxy.
So what you're saying is you're claustrophobic.
Yes, that's it.
All right, well, let's go, Catherine. I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully. Then I want you to take them out of the office with you and incorporate them into your life.
Well, shall I write them down?
Well, if it makes you comfortable, it's just two words. We find most people can remember them.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay, here they are.
Stop it!
I'm sorry?
Stop it!
Stop it?
Yes, S-T-O-P, new word, I-T.
So, what are you saying?
You know, it's funny. I say two simple words, and I cannot tell you the amount of people who say exactly the same thing you're saying. I mean, this, you know, this is not Yiddish, Catherine. This is English. Stop it.
So I should just stop it.
There you go. I mean, you don't want to go through life being scared of being buried alive in a box, do you? I mean, that sounds frightening.
Yes.
Then stop it.
I can't. I mean, it's been with me since childhood.
No. We don't go there. Just stop it.
So I should just stop being afraid of being buried alive in a box.
You got it. Good girl. Well, it's only been 3 minutes, so that will be $3.
I only have a five, so.
Well, I don't make change.
Then I guess I'll take the full 5 minutes.
Fine. All right. Well, what other problems would you like to address?
I'm bulimic. I stick my fingers down my throat.
Stop it! Nut of some kind? Don't do that.
But I'm compelled to. My mom used to call me fatty.
No. No, we don't go there.
But I've been having this dream.
No, we don't go there either.
But my horoscope did say...
We definitely don't go there. Just stop it. What else?
Well, I have self-destructive relationships with men.
Stop it! You want to be with a man, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, yes.
Well, then stop it. Don't be such a big baby.
I wash my hands a lot.
That's all right.
It is?
I wash my hands all the time. There's a lot of germs out there. Uh-huh. Yeah, don't worry about that one.
See, the concern is not never to feel afraid. The instruction is not never to have any anxiety, and if you have anxiety, you should have anxiety about that, because then you're sinning by having anxiety, and you should have anxiety about your anxiety. That would be really bad advice. The instruction is don't have tomorrow's worries today. Don't worry about things that aren't in your control when it's not time to worry about them yet. So, when you pay your bills when they're due or before they're due so that the lights don't get turned off in the future, that's not worrying about tomorrow, right? Paying your bills on time is today's worry. You're doing that today, but when you spend time saying, oh, how am I going to make it next month? And how am I going to make it the month after that? And what am I going to do about it? And there's nothing I can do about it. It doesn't help you. It doesn't add an hour to your life. And you know what helps you? Minding your business. That's actually a biblical idea that comes out of Thessalonians. Mind your own business. Keep track of the things that God has given you to keep track of. Have today's worries today. And focus on those. Focus on the things that the world needs you to focus on. If you have toilet paper that you are not going to use, if there is a crate of toilet paper in your house right now that is rolls upon rolls beyond the roll that's hanging in your bathroom for you to use because you're worried about someday, you're worried about tomorrow. And Jesus' advice to you is to look to the lilies of the field. To pay attention to how they are living and to what they have. They have the ability to enjoy the sunshine today. Have you taken this time to enjoy the sunshine? To engage with the advantages of more time with your family? More time at home, of a new way to experience church? Or have you been too worried? If you've been too worried, God wants to tell you that He's going to take care of you. Better than a lily, better than a sparrow, and better than a blade of grass. That while scary stuff happens, and it happens, and while bad stuff might happen to you, and bad stuff might happen to you, you don't have to worry about it. God is minding that business, and what we have to worry about is what we have to worry about. The worries of today, when you wash your hands, not so that you don't get sick, not because you're afraid of, oh no, what if I got the virus, but because you're being responsible. And because you are doing the thing you're supposed to do today, you're on track with the mission that God has sent us on. And that's the reason. I mean, if we look at Matthew chapter 6 in context, Jesus isn't giving like moral lessons and like a list of do's and don'ts for good Christians to follow. All right, good Christians, you worried about clothes and food, but you didn't worry about life, so you get 2 out of 3. Like, no, that's not. Instead, Jesus is talking to a gathered group of disciples, and those disciples are on a mission. They're sent to accomplish something. They're going to go and they're going to visit people's houses and they're going to tell them the good news that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. They're going to pray for them and they're going to communicate to them and they're going to invite them. And when they invite them, the result of the invitation is going to be new friends and new communities and a new way of engaging with God. An end of Judaism as we know it and the birth of Christianity. And someone is going to ask Jesus in the midst of him pitching this mission to these people, but what about my 401k? Where am I going to get the food from? If I'm not a fisherman anymore, where do I get fish? Jesus says, worry about the fish you have to eat today. Today. Don't worry about the fish you're going to have to eat tomorrow. Let that worry about itself. Let worry about that when it's today. And be amazed at how well things work out for you. We humans, we have this tendency to hoard. We have this natural tendency, and it is a sinful tendency, to buy in bulk and to stock up for a rainy day and to build bigger barns of stuff. And what we do when we do that is we think that the stuff is going to take care of us. We think that the stuff is going to keep us safe. I'm guilty of it too. For me, it's been food. That's my weak point, absolutely. And so this week, as I'm seeing restaurants closing and changing their business practices, I'm thinking, oh no, I'm not worried I'm going to die. I'm not worried I'm going to get sick. I'm like at peace with those possibilities, but I'm worried that I'm going to be eating rice and beans, and it's going to be really boring. And so I'm like, I better get the bacon cheeseburgers while I can. And that's been my worry about tomorrow. What if tomorrow is boring food? Can I have exciting food now? We all have these tendencies to me, to grab. But we're on a mission. Jesus has called us to something better than me. Jesus has called us to him. He's called us to be an instrument of his mercy to all nations. And in this time of worry, in this time of concern, We need to feel God's love for us and God's reassurance to us, God's protection of us, which, and God's protection includes God's sovereignty over life and death. God's protection includes the fact that if you get sick, or if you die, or if I get sick, or if I die, that will be the end of our suffering, and that will be the right time for that to happen, because God is in control of it. And if we can receive that peace, receive that message, then today we actually have a brilliant opportunity. The church needs to break out of the box. The church of Jesus Christ, the church which has been sent on a mission to change the world, has been for too many years stuck in sanctuaries. And we're out of the sanctuaries. And now the Spirit of God has a potential to break free. This could be the greatest outpouring of the Spirit of God that we have ever seen. Small group ministries, groups of five or less, that gather in the name of God for fellowship and for prayer with individual people in the midst of concern for one another, no longer able to submit to programming and pre-packaged religion, but needing to seek one another because they actually feel a need to seek one another. They need to be with one another, not because anyone's telling them, oh, it's time for church again, but because people are saying, I haven't been to church and I haven't been with the people I love for too long, and my soul needs that, and let me go and find a place. Even if I have to find a place online, even if I have to call my friends by phone, let's do it, and let's be creative, and let's create the new context. You know, I thought, College Park Presbyterian Church, that 2020, in our 2020 vision, we would focus on prayer. And we would focus on praying for two or more people in our network. But God has given us an opportunity to focus on new contexts and to think about what church could look like if it can't look like the church we know. And what an amazing opportunity that is. What an amazing potential there is if we don't give in to the worry. If we don't give in to the what ifs, and the what if it's bad, and the what if we don't like it, and the what if nobody else likes it, and we instead ask for the question, what if it's amazing? And what if new people are reached in this way by our ability to share and to engage and to be more flexible with schedules? And what if this doesn't work, I can create something different that would work, and together we can build something that can fill the world? If we all do our part today, what might God do? I'm excited, and I know it's hard, and I know, but you know, Tom Hanks had something to say about that.
Taking a little day trip?
No, Bob and I are driving home to Oregon.
You know, I really thought you were a ball player.
Well, you were wrong.
Was I?
Yeah. It is only a game, Jimmy. It's only a game, and I don't need this. I have Bob. I don't need this. I don't.
I gave away 5 years at the end of my career to drinking. 5 years. And now there isn't anything I wouldn't give to get back any one day of it.
Well, we're different.
daughter. You want to go back home to Oregon and make 100 babies? Great, I'm in no position to tell anyone how to live. But sneaking out like this, quitting, you'll regret it for the rest of your life. Baseball is what gets inside you. It's what lights you up. You can't deny that.
It just got too hard.
It's supposed to be hard. If it wasn't hard, everyone would do it. The hard is what makes it great.
God loves you. God loves you enough to be tough with you. And he loves you enough to be tender with you. God is here with you now, and so is your church. Through everything hard and through everything exciting, we are on your side. We are in your community, even if we can't be physically present in your house. And let's feel that. Let's feel that oneness together, not only with one another, College Park, but with all of the churches through all time and space, as we confess using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived.
Let's have one final hymn.
Yeah.
is such an incredible blessing that we have been given. It is as if our prayers for the will of God for this congregation have been answered, that he gave us this benediction to start using regularly months ago, that we need so desperately now to be deep in our hearts. So I bless you again with the benediction I've been using. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel's guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Smite death threatening.